Please note that this video has spoilers for the subject. Put off by how long this video is, don't worry, I try to jam-pack my videos with as much content and as much detail as I possibly can. Anything I feel I can comment on and that I feel you might be interested in, I pretty much put in the video. I try not to repeat myself and talk fairly fast. Neighbors 2, Sorority Rising, movie thoughts. I am going to start with the trailer stuff, and in doing so, I will of course be talking about a lot of stuff right off the bat that is not in the film, but is in the trailers. But I will be starting with declaring that the trailers for this retook the honor of the best trailer set to Kanye's Black Skinhead from The Wharf of Starfleet. I lose it at the slow-mo of like the couple being like, not this again. And then you see the sweet and welcoming Sorority. I love that. Like in the trailer, it's just, you know, slow down and you don't really hear. I love that in the film they actually accentuate because the Sorority are just so sweet and welcoming. They're like, you know, it's the stereotype of the kind of girl. They're so, you know, they're happy and cheery and just welcoming and just, you know, yeah. And they actually accentuate that, punctuate that with them. Actually, I forget the exact wording, but it is something like, hey neighbors or something. Just, yeah, I've watched these trailers so many times, and that particular bit is in a bunch of them. So just this, because, you know, Rogan and Byrne say so much in just this, you know, face, and then you see all the girls and they're like waving with both hands and all smiles, and like everybody turns around to face them. Hey neighbors. And it's just, yeah. And in the trailers, it looks like these girls actually, you know, it looks like it's Shelby who intentionally roofies Jimmy. And, you know, I like that as a, you know, reversal. And they even, you know, they of course make the Cosby joke, you know, obvious. And yeah, that is, I like that in the trailer as well. But in this, it's more like, no, don't drink the punch. Nobody drinks the punch. You know, Nora ends up, you know, roofied as well. And I love how the two have a kind of dumb off. They're like, you know, you're old. What are you doing here? Are you trying to shut down? Oh, it's just, and he accidentally completely spills the beans on it. And then they're like comparing how numb their tongue is as they're fighting and this whole thing. Yeah, that was a good, like, I mean, in the first, nobody is quite as stupid as Jimmy. But in this, for sure, Nora comes close. And yeah, it was a good little to have the two. Yeah. And the, in the trailer, you have the, you know, you see a little bit of the thing of they call their parents. And, you know, in the trailers just have, you know, him, the guy, I forget her name, but the one black girl of the Trinity of the Sorority, and he shows up and, you know, he's holding up these sex toys, and I, you know, this is a very big deal, and which, you know, it's like super obvious and such, but it's, I find it funny. I love that. I mean, yeah, I miss that a little bit in the film, But I love that if we had to get one or the other, I prefer what they gave us in the film. Kelsey Grammer comes in and is, I mean, Kelsey Grammer is hilarious. We've known that for decades now. And when is he most hilarious? When his kind of smart kind of thing is contrasted with this, like, not so smart and kind of maybe out of control. And so to have him, like, with her is just, that's hilarious. And, like, what are you talking? When did you start talking like Eminem? And just this thing, it's just, it's hysterical. That pizza has been out for so long, the cheese has gotten moldy. Cheese is mold. This is delicious. And and she just keeps chewing on that for the rest of it. And sometimes she's kind of pensive and she's kind of struggling with how disgusting what she's got in her mouth is. And I love that, you know, after all of that, it's like, do your sorority sisters like brunch? I need some new jeans. We could go shopping. And then he's like, you know, standing outside of the window. And I'm sorry, I tried, but you don't understand. When the girl's 2 years old, she listens. But now it's just, it's so hard. And it was just so nice to see her again. Can I hold? No, okay. And, you know, yeah, just so good. So funny. Always love me some Kelsey Grammer. Always hilarious. And I love them spelling sorority and the whole... I'm really glad that they left out of the trailers, because I loved when it was in the trailers. Teddy, like, patiently waiting for them. Okay, there's a U in the middle there that both of you are missing. That's so funny. Them both, you know, spelling, and it's like, you know, you think the titty is silent? Just, yeah. And the, you know, the bit with the cord on the phone, you know, gonna be hard to call the cops without a phone. And then she, you know, give us that back. No. And she runs, and the cord, you know, yanks her back. What is it? Oh, old people phone. She doesn't know what a cord is, and it's, yeah, it's. And the, I really, really like Jimmy as Heath Joker, basically, you know, with, and the manic laughter. Stop doing that, you know. And meanwhile, Paula's next to him, and she's like, "He's right. What are you guys talking about? He's, see, that's charming to me, you know." And just, and yeah, and the thing with the airbags, and, you know, in the trailer, you've got them trying to set them up in the house, and Rogan, you know, accidentally launches himself off one of them, and, you know, you've got them talking about it, you know, in the trailer, when we see them talking about it, yeah, that, they have that scene, but it doesn't have that bit in the scene at all, and then, you know, the one thing left is them in the garage. And I gotta say, in the trailer, this is where, like, Shelby really looks like a psychopath. Like, she's just gonna lock these people in the garage, and, like, and in the movie, she does, you know, I'm sorry, there's water. What did she say, like, power bars or something? And you know, there's the, and a poop bucket or something like that. And then, you know, they have the two jokes about how when Mac gets nervous, he poops. You know, earlier they had the mention so that we at least know for, you know, for the setup, for the payoff, and then, yeah, it's like, you know, if you, yeah, it's blink and you'll miss it. Really, you know, yeah, the second time, the first time, spent a few seconds on it, but that second time, but, yeah, I mean, that's fairly humane. Like she said, I'm sorry, I just need you to not call the cops before the party is over. And she does, there's water, and yeah. And the, you know, and the Teddy dancing, it's, you know, in both movies you have this, the, you know, in the first one it's, you know, you've got the dance off, you know, is this a dance off? I don't know. It's, you know, is that maybe what it looks like? I think it's a dance off, you know. We got a dance off, and suddenly Max got way more attention than he was hoping, you know, and yeah, and that entire scene is just amazing. I just rewatched the first one to remind myself of everything for the review, and yeah, that entire scene and Burns scheming. The first movie is almost worth watching just for that one scene, because it really just works. But yeah, you know, and as they're doing the dance, you know, Pete is like, not another dance-off. Another Wicca incident? And like, you know, and then in this, it's like, you know, how are we going to distract them? I'm going to dance. Just you dancing is enough. And, you know, and they're oiling him up, and it's like, I forgot the oil. It adds like two lines, and Jimmy just grabs this, like, and you know this fully cooked, like, I'm not sure if it's like a chicken or a turkey, but you know, it's, oh, that's hot. Okay, just keep going, just okay, here, and you know, and they're rubbing him up, and it's like, you know, Kelly. It's, you're done rubbing, you know, okay, is it, you know, Kelly, I just wanted to let you know, I'm still down, you know, dude, I mean, in the first one, at least you were enemies, it was like, although, actually, they weren't even enemies, when you know, she's a little flirt, like her mom, I bet, and it's like, inappropriate, and in this, yeah, just, and the actual dancing, and I love that, again, like I said in the review, when they actually, when it's not just like things happening, but they like slow down something, or they film it in a funky way, and, you know, edit it in a different way, that's some of the funniest in both of these movies. And yeah, him dancing like that, and the whole thing, you know. And you know, to be, when I wasn't sure, was it really that they were supposed to not recognize, you know, but, you know, when I saw the movie, and I, you know, because when, in the trailers, you don't necessarily realize that scene takes place after he's had a number of interactions with the girls, so they know what he looks like, but, you know, he doesn't claim to not, you know, he's like saying, you know, all is forgiven, and we're gonna, you know, and they have that whole dance, and the girls are just going wild. And then the moment that he actually, you know, he exposes himself, and then they say, oh no, that's, you know, and then suddenly it's not okay. And I don't know, I hope there's not like a double standard kind of thing going on. And I'm not like saying that it's on girls, that it's like, but it is kind of true, the, you know, this kind of thing of like when guys dance to, like, you know, or like male strippers or that whole thing, the moment that he actually, you know, you see the, you know, that's just one step too far. That's no longer okay. And again, I'm not saying that that's on girls. It's just, it's such a strange kind of, you know, that the moment that happens, it's just to, and I do think that, yeah, I like that was the climax of that particular scene, you know, and yeah, just that whole kind of, the that entire scene. I think that might be, in all of both movies, that's probably the single scene that where you most feel like there's a real scope, there's a lot here, and it's not just, I mean, that's, you get a real sense, there's a ton of people here, there's a marching band, there's, you know, you've got these, like, yeah, there's a ton of stuff going on in this one, you know, because, yeah, it's, you know, I forget what the exact arrangement was called, but they're trying to, you know, they're selling a lot of weed to make money for rent, and, you know, so there's food, and there's this band, and there's, yeah, all this stuff going on, and you really get a sense of this whole thing, and just the music. Both movies use music really well in scenes where there's a lot of people. The first one does use music during the parties incredibly well. Some of the best stuff, like the final party with Missy Elliott, and you've got and kind of the Machiavellian scheme of Burns, where they, you know, where it's, yeah, you've got the okay, suddenly it's a dance off, you know, you've got music specifically for that, and then you have the music for once the really sexy making out kind of stuff happens. You're, oh, you're like a possum, I'm a possum, and, you know, and then it goes back to the other music, and the, yeah, it's just so well done, so well used. And in this, I want to say it was Black Skinhead, but it was like they did something, and that's also, you know, in the trailers, when they use that, in part they use it in that scene, you know, you've got the band, and yeah, but I think, yeah, they used it, and they maybe slowed it down or something, I'm not entirely sure, but yeah, it's, yeah, that entire scene with, like, okay, we're done watching the dancing, and then they turn around, and you know, what does she say? That cheetah got our stash, you know, and yeah. And just the whole thing with her, like Shelby running the night, and she even says, I'm really glad that they did, you know, point out, and she, yeah, she yells, like, you really think you can get away from me? And I forget the exact term, but she's like, yeah, she's really athletic as this kind of, you know, and that's not like by accident. She works for this kind of, yeah, she's put a lot of effort into, yeah. So yeah, she can run, you know, fast enough, and you've got like Mac running out and the girls coming after him and the slow motion. Yeah, just that's so good. And you know, the again, in when you see it in the trailer, I honestly thought that there was going to be a lot of this kind of, like, you know, the, you know, Mac even says that they're using their sexuality as a weapon. You know, this, yeah, this scene really feels like it was the one left over when they, you know, I don't know, maybe originally it sexualized women a whole lot more, and then they cut it out because of, you know, poor reception at like early screenings or something. But I mean, it does really fly in the face of just the first time you meet the girls, it is this, yeah, you know, we don't want to be at parties that are where we are viewed as sexual objects. And then later, I mean, I'm not saying, you know, it's, there's nothing wrong with women being sexualized. The point is, who is sexualizing them? Is it at their expense, or is it, do they have the control? And they are sexualizing themselves in that situation. But it does feel like almost like something that they wouldn't usually do, kind of thing, with considering the rest. Because when you watch the trailers, you don't get the feminist message in detail. You just get they want to be able to throw parties. You know, that's it. And in the movie, it's like they want to be able to throw parties that they would actually like. And that's the idea that, you know, girls who want more than to just have sex with guys at frats don't have parties that, you know, yeah, that treat them as anything more than just there for sex with the, and then, yeah, considering that, it's, but I do really like in the, you know, in place of, like, really funny stuff in the climax, we have this really meaningful stuff. You know, you have them, like, standing there, you know, charging for entry, and then, you know, the guys are like, oh, I hope you send yourselves in later, you're really hot, and I hope to meet you inside the party, and they have to, like, you know, fake laugh and, you know, act like they're charmed by it. And then, you know, later when they actually do go in, you know, suddenly there's wet t-shirt and all this stuff, and then they end up actually sending the guys out. And yeah. Excuse me. And yeah, but nevertheless, I do really like the scene, both in the trailer and the movie, trailers and in the movie, of, you know, Mac walks out onto the, you know, into the yard, and there they all are, you know, and, you know, sunbathing, basically. And they, like, rip off his clothes as he's walking to the car. And once he, you know, gets into the car, they crawl all over the car. And, you know, and Kelly starts, you know, trying to hose them down. And, you know, it isn't working. You're only making them sexier, you know. And, you know, it's, suddenly it's a bikini car wash. You know, she was hoping to, like, you know, shoo them away, because, you know, nobody likes having water sprayed on them like that. But no, suddenly it's just like, you know, it's or it's an ad that would run during the Super Bowl or something, you know, an ad for what? Pick something. And yeah, it's like, I mean, it's there, it's almost, it starts out with just them on the lawn. It's almost like a sit-in, although to me, a sit-in is like what they did in the 60s, where, you know, they, or, you know, might do today, but where they're very, like, you know, they don't really make a big hassle out of it. They're just trying to, you know, fight for a cause and this kind of, you know, but here, you know, they're like, you know, loud, doing damage, really obnoxious. It's like a tea party sitting, that's it. And the with the really sweet sorority with Selena Gomez is also really, yeah, really, really fun. The when in the trailer you only see them do the clapping and the yay once. Almost immediately when the movie got to that scene, I was like, they're going to do that a bunch of times, aren't they? And then they do, you know. And I feel like they got really close. I think if they had one more of the big yay and everyone applauds in there, I think that would have been too much. And it wasn't the funniest thing, but it was a little funny. It's the you know, stereotype, which is of course also again where the movie struggles with the feminist, you know, messaging, that, you know, which is again, I mean, being a strong, independent woman doesn't mean that there aren't also, you know, kind of silly and, you know, girls out there who are just only into the really, really girly stuff. But it does, you know, yeah, it comes close to insinuating that, like, normal sororities, the sororities that already exist, are just, you know, these, yeah, kind of overly sweet and that kind of thing. But yeah, it is really great how it goes from that to then, yeah, actually, you know, suddenly she's sitting there and doing things that are like, that are so completely and utterly against the rules in the, yeah. And the you know, the bit with, then they go to her room to smoke, and then, you know, in comes that guy and he's like smelling them, and it's like, ah, it's okay. If you're doing drugs, we're doing drugs, you're doing drugs, you know. It was also, yeah, it wasn't one of the funniest, but it again was, there was some funny stuff there, and it's again just, the movie does not care. I mean, if he had to run around and act like that every single time someone did drugs, that would be ridiculous, you know. So obviously it's the movie exists in this world where people will suddenly react violently like that, and that's funny. It's funny when you have someone, because it seems like such a benign situation. They're just sitting there, they're smoking weed together, and, you know, and suddenly, you know, and in comes this narc, and it's like, oh, okay, he's one of the good guys. He's like, nope, he's a complete wacko about this. And then he comes in, didn't I just tell you to shut up? You know, it's just, yeah. It's good for the tone. It's good for the consistency. You never know when someone is suddenly going to... Maybe this is what they meant to do in the first one when scenes just went loud and obnoxious. I'm still looking at you. Robert De Niro theme scene. Now, the... But yeah, the... I, you know, in the trailer, you just see her with the joint, and then they say, we don't hit joints in here, you know. And I haven't seen Selena Gomez in anything other than just brief trailer clips, so I can only compare it to what she looks like in the Spring Breakers trailer, you know. But yeah, I mean, she does do it well. I mean, when she's talking about, we don't hit joints in here. I mean, she looks like, you know, the yeah, she looks like they, like, Shelby just brought in like an M80 or a grenade or something. She looks like this is not appropriate. This is wrong. This is all wrong, you know. And it's just, it's really, really funny because she's such, yeah. And again, that is funny when you have something really inoffensive and then you have someone completely overreacting. Maybe that's what they think the censors are like, really, because, you know, that's what the MPAA does when there's a doobie in a movie, you know. But yeah, and also because she's just been so calm and so happy, and then suddenly she's like, ah. And the come thing, it's almost like she's like a really lifelike android, and she's suddenly malfunctioning because this, you know, does error does not compute, just the you know, her face and voice and the whole, yeah. Yeah, she did fantastic. I've read on the IMDb trivia that she has like two minutes of screen time. That pretty much fits. Yeah, the moment that she like completely loses. Yeah, I thought she was phenomenal for that. So, yeah. And yeah, in the trailer you just see, you know, we don't hit joints in here. That it's not just that she's like, you know, lit a joint. When she first lies, you know, says, what are you doing? And then she's not like, oh, I guess you don't hit joints. No. She's like, oh, I'm sorry. Pecking order. I should have offered you the first, you know, the first hit. I'm sorry. Here you go. It's glass. This cost me like glass. This was really expensive. Glass. You know, that's, yeah, that's pretty good. And again, you know, so suddenly she's like, she's a Nazi. You know, she's like, remove that offending material from mine eyes. You know, it's, yeah. And they just have like, you know, just, that was very quickly produced. Of a glass, you know. Were they half expecting someone to whip out a doobie or something, or did some just, yeah, that was really, really, yeah, she's whipped them up into a really like effective little, you know, Hitlerjugend unit. It's that's yeah. And on that quote-unquote subject, it's so offensive, and I know I should feel bad, but I just, when they said, you know, oh, it's like, you know, we're Jewish and we're pregnant with the, so there's a Jew in the oven. That is so awful, that is so wrong, and that is so funny, because I kind of ate a little bun in the oven, and the moment you say Jew, yeah, this, and the bit with, you know, I think she found your dildo again, you know, it's, you know, we have one like that, you know, as well, except ours is black. That's, and then she spells it out, and then, oh, awkward, you know, and the, no, it's not a dildo, it's a character from a popular anime. I watch that show every night. And you know, in general, yeah, I thought the dildo thing, you know, obviously there are more, you know, it's a bit obvious of a joke, like, you know, film brain points out, oh, that's not a children's toy, that's a sex toy, you know, it's super obvious. But I do think some of the things they do with it are fun, like, yeah, like the examples I've just given. I do think it's too bad that the butter thing is not in the film, because that really did, I really did like that in the truth. Why is there a wrapper of butter? Oh, that's a good one, you know, this, yeah. And yeah, quite like the, you know, let's do what old people do best, stop young people from having fun. And I did kind of miss them bagging Shelby and her flipping, like backflipping out of the bag, and, you know, kicking Mac into the wall. Yeah, but I am really glad that her punching Jimmy as a clown is still in there. That's, you know, I hate clowns, you know, just, yeah, that's really, really funny, and just, Yeah. And the, you know, the scenes with the bit with painkillers, I thought it was a little too bad that the, like, they cut a lot out of the opening of that. They only really had the, you know, her crashing through and then rolling on the ground, and then I killed a girl, and she gets up. And I really love that the ending bit of that was not in the trailers, but was in the film. Him looking at after and yelling, "What is wrong with you?" Because that is, yeah, that is exactly the way you punctuate a bit like that. It's, "What is wrong with you?" That's, yeah. The you know, I forget which of, you know, the cinema snob, Brad Jones, he or one of his friends points out that her being on painkillers is apparently the kind of painkiller that also means that you can't get hurt. I think it would have been really funny if, like, when she got up and said she's on painkillers, that she was actually really clearly, really badly physically hurt. And, like, "I'm on painkillers." You're bleeding, you know, it's just, you're bleeding from 5 different spots. Go to a hospital, you know, that would have been really funny, but yeah. And I'm really glad that this did not have the, you know, any, like, really forced conflict between the, you know, with the couple, where in the first, you know, they have this, you know, breakup. The one thing relating to the breakup that is genuinely, I mean, the joke about, like, you know, they meet back up, and then, you know, Kelly is like, "She is so crazy," and he's like, "She's still behind you." That's a little funny. But that in itself does not justify the it's such a bad element of the first film. You know, you have to have, and that again, this film doesn't even bother with that. What? We have to have a conflict between the main, you know, for the protagonists, have them at their lowest end. Forget that, you know. And in the one thing that I do genuinely feel is good that could only exist with something like that being in the first, you know, other than the dude, we missed the airbag. The one thing is, I feel like we're going too far. Like, as a child of divorce, I'm starting to kind of sympathize with them. But my parents love each other, and I think it's hilarious. Touché. And I was wondering if a jar of urine would be a major plot point in this, but I suppose it could not claim all of the immaturity as far as major plot points go in recent cinema. I really like the follow-up on the, I should briefly say, the you know, the painkillers bit obviously is a, you know, a one-up on the throw stuff off the porch and then they think they killed the guy and then he survived bit. And that, again, in the first one, that's like a big thing. That, like, gets them like a strike. In this, never mentioned again. And that is what this movie, like, literally, it's as if the movie itself is on painkillers. It just, you know, rolls down the street and you're like, dead. That results in death. And the movie just gets up and it's like, nope, I can keep going. I love that. I really think that they made the exact right choice with just saying, nope, there's going to be consequences in this movie. I really love the sequel of the Office thing. You know, in the first one, there's some funny stuff in the Office, but you know, in the first one, you have the airbag bit, and then in this, you know, I forget the exact line, but you know, the supervisor guy, you know, they're at Jimmy's desk or something, you know, and like the supervisor's over there, and then they say some, you know, to explain to the supervisor, they say something like, we're at war with our college neighbors or something, and then he's like, airbags, oh no, and like a PTSD victim, he just explodes. Airbags, this is not a drill, everyone get out. And that's funny, and I mean, you know, the airbags bit is one of the things where the first film, where it does get genuinely crazy, and you don't really have too much consequence for it. And to then in this have that kind of consequence, because how would you react if that had happened? If you had witnessed with your own eyes two of the people working for you being launched into the air when they sat down at their desk, that is how you would react, you know. And you know, and not only does he yell that and run off, he then like, I forget, like he knocks something or he falls down or something as he's running. It's just, yeah, hilarious. And that entire scene, I love how they keep hitting Jimmy. You know, they walk, you know, where is he? He told me that you would say that. He told me that you would lie. You're such a bad liar. You know, where is he? And, you know, they keep, stop hitting me, you know. And that, again, in the first one, he has, stop hitting me. You know, and in this, they keep hitting, and, you know, Paul's like, what, hey, Kel, I'm here too, what is going on? He's like, tell her, why aren't you telling her, you know, and then the boss walks in, what's going on here? He knows where my husband is, and he's not, tell her, you know, that's funny. And it's also just like, at the end of the day, when someone who knows Jimmy well, is told by someone that they might not even really know that well. I mean, this is, she's Mac's wife. In the deleted scenes of the first movie, there's like, they like go to each other's house, you know, the Mac and Kelly goes to his house and meets some of his family and such. But otherwise, that's, you know, as far as we know, that's not in continuity. That's the deleted scene. So this might be one of the rare times he even meets Kelly, because why would she show up at her husband's? She's got other things she needs to deal with, you know, so, but yeah, you know, oh, it's Max. Okay, I am aware of your existence. I am aware of your relation to people in my employ. What brings you here? What is going on right now? And the moment that he finds out that apparently that Jimmy might be lying about where someone is, he's like, why are you always doing this, Jimmy? Just tell her. You know, it's just, it's so easy, so readily accepted. And then in the middle of all of that, okay. He's in jail for child pornography. And just the moment that he says that, everybody's cracking up. It's like, no, what? And we don't even know. We don't know yet at that point that that's not it. And then the moment, you know, and then she's like, what? And then he's like, no, I just made it up. I just want you to, you know, what does he say? I want you to stop hitting me, or I was just making something. I don't remember exactly what he says, but the fact that he lied about that, and that's what, that's where his mind goes, you know. What gets fraternities more, you know, what gets them disbanded? What gets them in the most trouble? Rape. I am sorry. I am so sorry, you know. That's where his mind goes, you know. Rape, child pornography, you know, just, yeah. And that again, you know, great follow, great one-up of that. Of, yeah. And the, I think that was about it for that particular scene. And then the, you know, the couple who want to move in to the house, you know, you have the brief bit where, oh, they're fumigating. They're so nice. It's a big house. They're religious. So they procreate like crazy. I forget if that was actually, if she actually spells out that that's what she means. That's what I took from it. They're religious, they're the Duggars. You're gonna live next to the Duggars, basically. But yeah, that's the and then proof they exist. If you have to say it like that, you're probably, yeah, too subtle. And the yeah, it's you know, and they're standing there and they're Jewish, they're really Jewish. And then it's wow. And the yeah. The you know, the Mac and Kelly, and then the new, you know, the people who want to buy the house, and then the realtor lady, and then the other guy, the guy who sold the sorority, the house next door, you know. And I love this guy, you know. Just every, like, this is again, like, in the first movie, they were trying to, some characters, everything they said was supposed to be funny. This guy, everything he said was actually funny. You know, he comes in, you know, so, as a sorority, oh, my phone's ringing. Did his phone actually ring? I'm sorry. This is another sorority. They also want to buy this place. They're kind of alternative, and, you know. And Teddy's like, oh man, I gotta take just one more trip down this one. You see, so, you know, smashes down through the table, and they're like shocked. And then he runs in. I am not legally responsible for that. There's a beautiful centaur over there. Is that because she was sitting on a chair and she thought that he had four legs? Yeah, wow. Anyway, then why is he here? Because you did not tell us. You lied to us. You did not tell us that we would be living next to a sorority. They're very nice people. You haven't met them. I'm sorry, but we literally drove past and saw them rob you, and you didn't do anything. And it again, like, the, you know, the immediate punchline is, you know, you know there's this hope that, well, if they haven't seen what the sorority do, it's okay, we can say that you haven't seen the sorority, right? They're actually really nice. But then, you know, you can't, because we actually saw them rob you. So, okay. You saw them and you didn't do anything. And then they're like, can you defend? Look, you're the one who lied about the sorority. We don't have to, like, you know, stop actual literal burglary in progress because we're offended. Like, you know, and that's another thing. They literally robbed the place, and the cops are not called because that's the world that this movie lives in. You know, you don't even really know, like, there's no real, like, why don't they just call the cops? You know, they really, the only time we see the police particularly, are they in the climax? The one thing I for sure remember is that they get, you know, they send them after all the other drug dealers so that they're the only ones selling weed, you know. So the police exist in the universe that this particular movie takes place in, but they just don't call, you know. They literally, they come home to an empty house and they don't call certainly we don't see, and that's funny. That's mental, and that's funny because it's just what are they going to do next? How are they going to top this one? And the movie just keeps going there, and just, yeah. And I really, really like the bit with her last name, her maiden name, Duh-hun-dee. You know, I had to ask myself, who are you, Kelly Duh-hun-dee? Your last name is Dundee? It's got an H. It's a different name. Like Crocodile Dundee? This is, you know, and so it's like Crocodile Dundee. It's a different name. Okay. I have a feeling she's heard that one before. And she's not a fan. And the thing, okay. He's in Australia, you know. Actually, he like calls Jim because that phone number did not get messed up. And, you know, it's so typical. They don't look at the phone number and realize that it's the wrong number because, you know, we rely on, you know, it says the name right here. Obviously, it's going to the right person when the, yeah. Well, okay, I can't answer it. Okay, I honestly, for a second there, I thought that she would actually answer the phone and try to do the accent and the voice or something. But yeah, and you know, love how every message that they wrote was just super, like, this is a, you know, what, 18-year-old girl saying that, you know. So, you know, what's going on? What's things and stuff, you know. That's because that's, yeah. And the yeah, you know, she's okay, where did she go? I know where she went. And then we don't see it for a little while. And then, I'm in Australia. I got your text. Meet me in, you know, Sydney, Australia. Okay, I'm gonna go do the thing, and then I'm gonna return, you know, and you know, it took me 18 hours to get here. Where are you? And then he comes back, and he's like, I haven't slept in 4 days. It's 3 o'clock where I am in Australia right now. And in general, I love the bit with the self. I love how stealth this, like, in the first one, there's this brief bit where, like, they hide under the table, but, you know, make a noise. And you know, Dave Franco, Pete, goes in to inspect. This jello is moving. There has been movement right here. And that's also a great little, because that keeps moving for a little while after. So he, you know, it's like he's, you know, what is that thing? Like the, you know, yeah, he's finding a trail. He's finding something that the criminal left behind, and he's checking to find out how recently was, you know, was the person still here? And then they throw a bottle, and he's like, Scoob, Shaggy, check it out. And, you know, and it's the mystery machine. All going, like, you know. And that's, like, the one time that they do stealth. In, you know, and then you've got Jimmy's What do you do? I'm walking silently, you know, just, yeah. In this, the possibly not Nora, but the other two members of the Trinity are ninjas. Like she, you know, the black girl, she gets the, yeah, she gets Max, you know, and then it turns around and she like instantly ducks down behind the counter and she's just gone. You know, he never said, and to be fair, you know, Teddy, yeah. But yeah, I'll get into that in just a second. But and then you have, you know, oh, that's real good. You just taught your daughter, you know, to cuss. What's she watching on that thing? Goodfellas? Ha! I don't even know what she's watching. That makes it better. Yeah. Shelby steals Kelly's phone, and you know, and she's like really carefully, and Stella is looking right at her, you know, and there's even, don't they make eye contact for at least a little bit there? You know, and Stella even like actively like, I don't know, waves at her or something, you know, and it's like the sisterhood, sorority. You'll understand more as you get older, but just know this is for us, this is for our gender, you know. And she gets in there and gets the cell, and then at the end of it, you know, Rose Byrne, the actor, is like, do you sometimes see children? Do you sometimes see people that I don't see? I mean, I haven't even watched the Insidious films, but yeah, that's meta, isn't it? And the Teddy with the food, it's like, okay, so now the water's warm, and you know, so now we're gonna put the eggs in. You're gonna make eggs in that? Oh, totally. You can do that. And you know, and ow, that's really hot. I told you it's hot. I thought it would be like jacuzzi hot. This is actually hot. Because this is, he's, you know, he literally can't boil an egg. You know, he doesn't know that when you know, that it's gonna be really, really hot. That's literally just, yeah. And then he's like, how could it possibly make the egg hard? It makes pasta soft. You've got a point. And the, you know, and I also gotta love how he has these little, he's like an idiot savant, or what it's called. You know, there's like, there are things that he does, like, you know, okay, they have this much wheat. If they sell it all, they'll make this much money. It's, you are really good at math. No, I'm good at pot. But can you just transfer it to like, what if you were buying like, you know, meat, whatever, like steak, like burgers, grams of burger. Why would I buy grams of burger? Yeah, it's like, yeah, I do think that the, you know, the ending there, oh, he's really good at arranging, you know, I mean, the thing with, it's probably so they can have the joke about, again, you know, to, you know, whether it's to women or to gay guys, Teddy's really attractive. So, you know, the thing about having set up the wedding and that's now his business, it's a bit, yeah, it comes right out of nowhere, frankly. But they did kind of need to give him something, you know, and then and we have the couple actually move into a new house. Film Brain said he was almost scared of them doing a third one. I'm not sure. Do they have, like, I mean, they've had a fraternity and a sorority. Do they have one for intersex or like, is yeah, I don't know quite where they would go, and for sure, I mean, they've legitimately moved them to another house. They even say we can't even see your neighbor from here. I don't know if that's like maybe it was in someone's contract that we will let you make another neighbor's movie, but you will not make a third one. And just to make sure, you are to state that they now can no longer see their neighbors and they're living in a place that they're not going to be moving away from, so that it just cannot happen. Somewhere someone was absolutely neurotic about that. And so we have that ending scene. But yeah, the and then they're just renting the place for the actually, if a fraternity moved into a third house on the and then because Mac and Kelly are still renting that place, the place that they lived in for most of these two movies, and then they might have to help out. Shelby and Teddy could come back. He has history with them, and then fight, and then it's sorority versus fraternity. That is something they could do. My contact information for you Hollywood producers now. Yeah, the ending with Teddy as the gay wedding planner. Yeah, they kind of had to give him something, you know, they gave closure to the others. And yeah, they definitely had to give him something. And you know, weed wouldn't, excuse me, wouldn't be, yeah. But I mean, I guess, you know, he did run that thing that, yeah. And the thing with it, like, you know, it doesn't even matter if you have a record. It doesn't? I mean, wouldn't it scare off a bunch of customers? Does he not have to state that? Don't you for a bunch of jobs? Anyway, I do love that, you know, when they're meeting, oh, what are you doing here? All right, you live here. And it's we got kind of crazy, huh? I have a record. It's really hard for me to get a job, you know? And it's like, oh man, this is, yeah. But I love how they almost kind of adopt Teddy. And that's how, you know, they even say that by the end, that's part of how they know they're going to be good parents, at least some of the time, because they did well with Teddy, you know? And the, yeah. The final scene when we, you know, when all three children are there and everything, you know, you do have the joke with the, you know, oh yeah, you know, our kid plays with the dildos as well, but it's the, yeah, you know, this much more lifelike and anatomically accurate dildo, and you know, I would not let my, it's got veins, it's got balls, you know, but yeah, the you know, so you have that joke, and you do, you know, we're gonna have sex in some years. No, we're not, because my parents are gonna raise me to have much too much respect to be around someone, you know, to be attracted to someone like you. And I swear, and I'm certain I'm not the only one. I was waiting for at least one of them to drop the baby. I know that's dark, but there was set up for it early. Maybe it's on the cutting room floor, actually, because they both dropped Stella when she was 6 months old, I believe. So yeah, but yeah, they adopt Teddy, and it's like, you know, so what are you thinking you're gonna do, you know, for the rest of the day? Because they, you know, they've literally just met him that day, you know. Yeah, he came to them earlier that day, and then they, you know, tried to ruin the sorority thing, and you know, okay, so that, you know, some hours have passed. What, you know, what next? I'm probably gonna like play with my phone for a while, and maybe eat. Then I'm going to sleep in my car. That is so sad. It's also like, you know, he's telling me, I quit my job. We didn't tell you to do that. That one's on you, buddy. You know, and the, yeah. And the, yeah, the, you know, it's like, you know what, you can spend the night though. Are you sure? Yeah, you can be in Stella's room. She takes up this small of a, and that's exactly the argument he made to Pete and Darren earlier. You know, those, yeah. I feel like Darren was a little bit of a, again, maybe it's on the cutting room floor. I feel like there could have been more funny with him. He's kind of just safe and, you know, nice and a little bland. And it's really too bad because there was some really funny stuff with him. Like when, you know, when Pete is trying to go, because Darren has not known Teddy for as long as Pete has, and Pete is like trying to calm Teddy down and say, just, you have to think about, you know, and this, and he's doing, and I love that in the first one also, where he is like just trying, because he knows that Teddy is mentally unstable. This guy is, you know, just a hint of a fraction of an adjustment away from a complete mental breakdown. So he's like kind of, and then Darren says, you know, and Teddy snaps. That was just, you know, and Pete is like, oh no. Yeah, that's, yeah. Anyway, they make that argument, and then he ends up sleeping in there, and he's lying there, and you see Stella there, and then he's lying next to her in the other thing, and he's also turning her over, and I love what they did with Teddy in this. In the first one, he has a lot of the funniest, and you almost kind of wish he had even more screen time, even though he's such a major part. And then in this, of course, he's an even bigger part because everybody loves him in the first one. And we wanted more of him, and we got it. And they actually came up with ways to do, you know, yeah, interesting things to do. You know, I mean, in the first one, the fact that he's stupid doesn't come up that much. In this, it's a running gag. You know, in the first one, it's the, you know, AT&T thing, and then, you know, you could be president of the United Nations. There is no president of the United Nations. That's what I'm talking about. You know things like that, and I don't. You know, and in this, yeah, every so often, it's just, yeah, he clearly does not. He genuinely does not understand how the world around him works. You know, it's like if he can't have sex with it, get high off it, drunk off it, or eat it, then it's a foreign concept to him. And that, yeah. And they make both him and Jimmy stupider, for sure. And it's just, it's so funny. And I really love the barefoot run, where it's like, you know, you can tell that he's getting close. This is, you know, he's not taking this well. And it's like, what did you expect? Well, you know, I could just stand, you know, and just, yeah. And the, yeah, it's like, where are you gonna go with your thing? You know, I'm gonna go for a run. Don't you want to at least put your shoes on and, you know, and cut? And again, we have one of these great, you know, it's not just something happening. You know, you have this pan, slow pan up, and you see he is indeed running completely barefoot, you know. And as this music, I don't remember the exact song, but it's some like really lonely kind of music. And, you know, it comes to the top, and you see his face, and he's just bawling as this, you know, slow-mo run of sadness and loneliness. And it's just, it's so funny. And it's just, yeah, it's they really knew how to get, because at the end of the day, you need Teddy in the, you know, in the house that was Delta Size, you know, right next to Mac and Kelly, right before the sorority move in. So, you know, it's you have to get a little bit contrived there, because they need to be going into that house and he needs to be in that house already. And then, you know, so you need some kind of, but it makes sense that he would go back to, you know, that he felt safe there, you know. And you have to have this kind of thing where, like, you would expect him to talk with the other guys, and maybe one of them knew a friend that he could sleep on the couch of until he has, you know, more permanent plan. You know, they're not kicking him out. They're trying to say, we need to find another way to... He kicks himself out, basically. You know, he says, if that's how it's going to be, then I'm not... Okay, fine. You know what? I'm going to get out of here. Don't even worry about it. You know? And, yeah, and they get such a funny, you know, him... You know, leaving without shoes is funny. Him, the lonely, sad, barefoot, slow-mo run of sadness is funny. And him being found in the place is funny. And, you know, crashes through the table from the zip wire. And I'm not legally responsible for that. Just, yeah. And I think that the film did a good job of, you know, you have the early video of, like, this is how it's going to work for the sorority. You need, what was it, 5 full can, you know, yeah, 5 full cans of money for rent per month. And, you know, and then at the end, it's basically like a joke, like as if they actually know how much, but it's a good, like, you know, then during the pot sale, it's like, how many bags, you know, how many cans of money, you know, and the, or is it this, anyway, I wonder if that's as vague as I think it is. Yes. And the... Yeah, you just have... Yeah, it... That way you can very easily and very quickly get a sense of how well is... You know, oh, you can join our sorority, just throw the money in the can. And then you see them, and you see all this money accumulating in the can. And then, you know... We offer you 4 cans a month. 5 cans a month. We accept. You know, the, yeah. And the, I really like some of the, like, you know, so they're throwing these parties that are for them, that are the kind of parties that they want to throw, and they have themes, and then one of them is like, you know, the, The Fault in Our Stars, and they're sitting there watching, and they're all bawling their eyes out. And Teddy is sitting there with him in the shirt, and he's also crying, and just, yeah, is really funny. And when Teddy himself is also talking about sisterhood, and yeah, this, and the, and I also really liked, well, I forget who said it, but there was someone who said, like, as a man, I think that these women, you know, this, yeah, and Jimmy saying, like, make them make out, you know, because he's still, and it's that kind of, yeah, they still, you know, some men, when they see that many you know, young, attractive women, that's, you know, that's all they can think about. And the, and I do think that that, you know, they could have not had anyone say that, but having Jimmy say it does kind of say, you know, if you look at a group of young women and, you know, you just think, ah, you know, can't they, you know, do something sexual for my male gaze, then, you know, you're as stupid as Jimmy. And wasn't he, like, recently roofied at that point? So it's like, you know, you're not just Jimmy stupid, you're roofied Jimmy stupid. And the, I think, and I do also quite like, you know, they're at the end where, you know, Teddy and Pete are talking. And again, and, you know, the two of them together are really quite good. You know, Dave Franco as Pete is one of the best parts of the first one. He really, you know, he gets to be, you know, really one of the really destructive frat members. You know, he's the one with the bush, after all. And, you know, he also, you know, and the, he's one of the only good parts of the Robert De Niro party scene. And, yeah, the fact that it, you know, there at the end, it really reaffirms that, Teddy and Pete really deeply care about each other, you know, and the thing, you know, he loves you and he will always love you and he'll always want to be friends with you. We're not talking about Darren anymore, are we? No. And I really like when, you know, when Teddy first meets the sorority girls and he, you know, he's like, why do you want to throw your own party? Because frat, why don't you just go to frat parties? Because frat parties suck. And then he's like, you know, listing all the themes. And then they point out, you know, they're all sexualizing women. And it's, and it's, and it, it's so funny. And or but, it's also, that's totally what it is. You know, when suddenly it, you know, when someone realizes that for the first time, you know, it doesn't matter if they're in a fraternity or it's just, you know, when they suddenly realize sexism exists and is extremely, persistent and, there's another word I want to say, but I forget which it was. It's, yeah, that there's so much of it. You know, sexism, you know, other, yeah, the moment that you are made aware of some great injustice and how pervasive it is, that was the word, then, yeah, it is like that. And, you know, in a way you can kind of see maybe yourself or someone you know in there. And then it's also just that, you know, Teddy is really, you know, I mean, he, yeah, you know, the first did not have a lot of female, much female presence at all, but it did tend to be that any woman who wasn't like you know, you have Kelly and Paula, but other than that, the, you know, and the real estate lady, of course, but other than that, the girls were typically just college girls and they were there for, you know, for the frat. They, you know, they were the sexual objects of, you know, the film would show them the same way it would show the shot glasses or the weed or the mushrooms. It's like, see, the frat party even has this object for male pleasure. So, you know, it's you would almost think that this was made by completely different people. It's yeah, I mean, I everyone, you know, involved in making both of these movies, you know, anyone who worked on both of them, not just one of them, has probably had a oh moment. You know, it's yeah, that really is incredible that it did end up so, yeah. I'm trying to think if there was anything else I wanted to say. I want to make sure to mention in this video as well, I really love the Asian girl. And I suppose that might more or less come. I do think that it worked with the, like, you don't know much at all about the, you know, yeah, the trinity of the sorority, but yeah, you know, you have this thing, you know, Shelby didn't have any friends in high school, and she never felt like she was part of something, that she really belonged, and that kind of thing. And, you know, I mean, even that, you know, when she first lights up the joint, you know, it's not only setting up, you know, and showing how different she is from what the sorority expects and what maybe is expected of the sorority, but it's also, you know, the fact that she does, you know, it, one, it didn't occur to her, and two, it is the first thing she does think of when she realizes that something is wrong about the fact that she is sitting there with, you know, toking on a joint. The fact that there might, that maybe she should have offered it to the, you know, the president of the sorority, you know, she's not used to, like, being in a group, being part of, like, or maybe at least not to where that's a good thing or something, you know. So it yeah, it both shows that, you know, she wants to do drugs. She's, you know, she's a young woman. She wants to do drugs. She's in college. So, you know, it's supposed to be part of the experience. So it's, you know, it's not like it's not like she did produce a grenade. So, yeah, you know, that she, you know, she doesn't necessarily understand, you know, kind of group mentality. She wants to do drugs, and that she had expected that it would be okay for her to do drugs in this, you know, in this sorority. And I do also think, I mean, when I first saw yes means no at the frat party, I thought that it was just going to be like shock humor, the way that, you know, the police brutality, that's just shock humor. There's nothing actually funny. Although the cop says, this is your training day, and then he says, what do you, have you not watched Training Day? That is something that you need to address. Anyway, yeah, the go eat a lasagna or hate a Monday, Garfield. The fact that it wasn't just like, you know, this kind of shock humor kind of thing, that it was actually them, you know, then they point out, it's basically saying that, you know, okay, you, if you go upstairs, then you can have sex with the frat guys. You know, that's the, you know, because that is the, you know, yeah, that there's, you know, when you see yes means no, when the message yes means no is, you know, the messenger who is conveying that message, you know, either you just agree to that, you know, those premises, the idea that, yeah, the girl is going to have sex with the guy. That's just how it is. Or you leave, and the movie is, you know, has them leave, and it's not a joke. And again, I really, at first, it didn't feel to me like the movie was trying to say this is bad before the characters actually before they specifically said it, you know. And then you have the clear comedic, like, you know, they say, oh, it's like an arrow up to where we go to have sex with them. Oh, there actually is an arrow up to when, yeah. And whether or not you know, maybe don't realize it before they say it, or maybe, you know, maybe you do, but one way or the other, that early scene does say fraternity parties are about getting girls to have sex with the guys. And that's not what, you know, and there are quite a few girls in college who want to be at a party with other college people where that isn't the, you know, at all the point or the theme. And yeah, that's, I approve. I've reviewed other parts of this franchise. The links are in the description box. Please comment, thumbs up, and subscribe for more content.